Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of Waiting for Aphrodite, Journeys into the Time Before Bones, by Sue Hubbell, narrated by Barbara Caruso. This work is copyrighted 1999 by Sue Hubbell. This recording is copyrighted 1999 by Recorded Books Incorporated. Sue Hubbell, the nature writer who took us on a tour through the world of bugs in broadsides from the other orders, now leads us through some of the mysteries of time, geological, biological, and personal, as she writes of the evolution of life on this planet and the evolution of her own life. And now, Waiting for Aphrodite.
Prologue. For 25 years, I lived on a 90-acre farm in the Ozarks of southern Missouri. For a number of those years, I lived alone after my first marriage ended. But in the mid-1980s, I married an old friend, Arne, a man who worked and lived in Washington, D.C., and we bought a house there that's even older than we are. I began commuting regularly, every couple of months, between the two places, but not in the summertime. Arne and I share a number of crotchets that make young people look amused. We don't watch television, we don't have a fax machine, computer, cellular telephone, or microwave oven. And most important to my point here, our house lacks air conditioning. Summers in Washington are, if anything, more humid and hotter than they are in southern Missouri. So we began renting summer places in New England. In antique Victorian fashion, I would take up residence there, and he, who had an air-conditioned office to escape to, would join me when his work permitted. I have lots of connections to New England, some created during the 5 years that I lived and worked in Rhode Island. And I've been visiting Maine for the last 50 years, had grown to appreciate the year-round beauty and interest of the land along its coast. But it wasn't until just a few years ago that I began to think seriously about making it my home. Missouri had been home for a long time. My first husband and I had driven the 7 miles of bad, rocky, rutted road to the farm for the first time with a real estate agent. And at the end of the driveway, we had found a dilapidated cabin and a run-down farm that somehow, in its blousy, generous beauty, I'd known would be home. During the 25 years I lived there, I created a beekeeping and honey business, turned the place into something that was more nature park than farm, and restored the worn-out land. But the work was hard, and 60 is not 35. At 60, Missouri farmers begin to make plans to sell the old homestead and move to town. I was not interested in moving to town because the years had brought development to it. Plans were in the works to bring a 4-lane divided highway through, the final connection of a southern superhighway between the east and west coasts. In a few years, my Missouri town would be a service area. I had returned to one particular summer cottage on the coast of Maine for several years before I realized that one reason I kept coming back was that the nearby town was a Yankee version of what my Missouri town had been when I had first moved there, before it had traffic lights, before Walmart and McDonald's stripped its downtown. I decided that this town in Maine was the place I wanted to grow old in. During the course of my visits to Maine, I must have driven by the house on the hill, with its weathered for sale sign, hundreds of times. The place had been vacant and available for so many years that it had become invisible, and in fact the little house could not be seen from the road. But one hot afternoon, at the end of 2 desultory months spent with real estate agents, looking at all the wrong properties along the Maine coast, I did see the sign as I was driving back to the rented cottage. I was tired and discouraged, but the dogs, Tassie and Louie, needed to get out of the car anyway, so with a sigh, I turned up the crumbling blacktop driveway and saw the disappointing house. Ugly, boxy, a 1950s ranch, trying to make more of itself than it should have. I let the dogs out to run around in the untended yard, where iris and lilies were blooming among the wildflowers. The dogs checked the place out, tails wagging, and I sat down under the shade of a maple tree that unaccountably fit my back perfectly. I looked east toward the next day's sunrise and saw the sea. A breeze was blowing, and I could smell salt, seaweed, and sun-bleached shore. I knew once again that I'd found home. Houses can be fixed. I was surprised that this strange little house was going to be my home, so I got up from under the maple tree, whistled up the dogs, and decided to look around. Together we scrambled up over the ledge in back of the house, crossed the moss and lichen-covered boulders, walked through the groves of pine, spruce, maple, birch, and fir that grew where there was soil enough to sustain them. The blueberries were not yet ripe, but soon would be. From the bald, rocky crown of the hill, I could see the entire ocean bay, the islands lying in it, and the sea shining beyond. Climbing back down, I found a rock-encircled spring shaded by trees. In another age, it would have had its very own naiad. Louie thought it was lovely and threw herself in for a drink. But she was startled to find it so deep that she had to swim, and scrambled out onto the rocks with difficulty. Back at the house, I tried to peer through the windows, but the blinds were tightly drawn. A week later, a real estate agent let me inside. It was bad. The rooms were low-ceilinged and cramped. The windows were small, with light showing around the edges of the jambs, which meant they'd be drafty in the winter. A sump pump ran nearly full-time, removing standing water from the cellar. Lime-green shag carpeting covered the floors throughout. Bad, bad, bad. But not too bad. The carpets probably hid perfectly decent hardwood flooring. I could rip off the roof, build up, top the house off with the glass tower I'd always wanted. Knock out some ceilings, knock out some walls. Ungirdle the place, allow it to sprawl a little. Perhaps some porches, replace the windows. The freestanding shop could be turned into a guest house for the people who always come to visit you in Maine. Not bad at all. I knew that this time I didn't have 25 years to build everything myself, the way I had done in Missouri, but I knew an architect. I knew a contractor. I had a wrecking bar. I phoned Arn in Washington and told him I had found a place that I thought would work out. He flew up for a weekend. Arn has made do a great deal in his life, but he's never ripped off roofs or knocked down walls. He was also educated at Oxford, where he acquired formidable rhetorical skills. He looked around the house, then turned to me and said, "Well, it is just awful. But if we buy it, I can't see that there's that much wrong with it." Buy it we did. We hired an architect and a contractor, and during the summer I camped out in a house in process. The plumber whom the contractor hired is a wise man. He knew the place. He'd done work for the previous owners. He agreed with me that the house needed improvement and said he'd enjoy helping. "It's such a pretty spot," he said. "What if you'd found a really nice house in an ugly place? Now that's what would be bad." All that summer, backhoes ditched for drainage and new foundations. Trucks moved earth from here to there. Concrete was poured. I applied my wrecking bar. I smashed all the pink and gray ceramic tile in the bathroom with a sledgehammer and shoveled it out. Arn flew up weekends and grimaced at the piles of dirt and fill. He winced as the plumber slowly and noisily drilled a hole for the guest house plumbing through what Arn said was a perfectly good wall. But I showed him the spring, and before long he was cutting a pretty walking trail up to it. He explored on his own and found the USGS marker at the peak of our tiny mountain. He found a cove where the seawater was warm enough to swim in. He found the best place to buy fresh-picked crab meat. Arn may do, making, in his way, a home, too. Adding Maine to my life was easy. It happened gradually over a number of years of visiting, summer renting, buying a place, beginning work on it, making friends. It all seemed natural, fitting, proper. But subtracting Missouri from my life was hard. I knew with my head that the time had come to let my place go. The hard physical work of managing a large bee farm in an isolated area, miles from neighbors at the end of a bad road, seemed more difficult as each year passed. Arn and I, over the last few years, had been taken up with concern and care for aging relatives and friends. and from them I had learned that there are good and bad ways to grow old. The details differ in each case, but the bad ways have a number of similarities. A rigid, gripping conservatism, leading to a fearfulness of new things, new people, new places, and a reluctance to leave a way of life that worked at 45 but does not work any longer. The good ways to grow old all include a frame of mind that welcomes change and new beginnings and a talent for letting go. It was time for me to make changes while I was still young enough to make a new life, become part of a new community, make new friends in an easier place where I could remain independent longer. I had learned all that, but it was a matter of the head. There was still a problem with the heart. Although my farm was not the same place it had been before it was homesteaded more than 100 years earlier, it was a very pretty spot, filled with wild things living out their lives in a way I hoped they found satisfying. I knew I did. My land was between a State of Missouri natural area and the first U.S. Park Service scenic riverway. The use restrictions on those pieces of public land extended the habitat I had helped create. 25 years of work had made the place a part of me, even as I grew to understand that I, a particular human being, was irrelevant to it. In the end, it was that understanding from the place itself, with its own species of magic, that taught me to let go of what was not important, deed and title, and to hold to the part of it that was, memories of my time there, the integrity of the place, the lives being lived out there. After we bought the house in Maine with its 5 acres, I got in touch with the Missouri Department of Conservation, which had indicated that it might be interested in adding my property to the existing natural area. Natural areas stay forever wild. I had learned at a very early age to be skeptical of the word forever. But if the MDC kept the place wild until governments fell, that would be as good as humanly possible, and the best I could do for the wild things living there as I looked up the years to an unknowable future. The MDC people paid a visit, liked what they saw, and by the time the demolition work in Maine was done, we had worked out a deal. The last week of September, on the day before I started packing up to leave Missouri, I had a party and invited everyone to come. I was feeling sentimental and nostalgic and wanted to gather around me people I'd come to love. I wanted to mark the passing of my place from private to public ownership. The weather cooperated. It was one of those clear, bright-skied autumn days. The Ozarks were at their winsome best. Goldenrod and asters bloomed out in the field. Sumac leaves were bright red around the wood's edge. Some of the best friends I'd ever had came to the party. Good old boys, the reformulated hippies, the town gentry, neighbors, and the feds from the scenic riverway. I stopped talking with people at one point and took a mental snapshot. Children, some of them honorary grandchildren, were running around, tumbling, laughing, screaming. Couples were walking out into the open field, heading back toward the woods to walk the trails. My friend who makes homebrew was dispensing it. Others were standing around eating from paper plates, talking, smiling. It was not a sad party. It was just the party I wanted, a cheerful one. I'd asked the MDC to send a representative to mark the new ownership, and as a surprise to me, the young couple who would be moving into the house were the ones sent. He is a botanist, recently assigned to a new department position in the area. I took them around, showed them the house's quirks, pointed them in the direction of the trails. When they returned, they had fallen under the magic of the place and couldn't wait to move in. It turned out they even kept bees. If I'd written an order for successors, I couldn't have done better. So in the very end, those ending days when I packed my belongings and drove down the driveway for the last time, I was content. And I took with me that photo album of the mind, images that could not be packed up and carried away by North American van lines. There was that one of the party, to be sure, and lots of others. Let me show you just one. I'm walking down to the mailbox, which is 1.25 miles from the house. To get there, I cut through the abandoned field belonging to a neighbor. The wind picks up, smells of weather, blows my hair across my face. The clouds, which had been promising rain, rush across the sky, lower, and turn a deep blue, slate. A flock of goldfinches, feeding on the seeds at the ends of grass stalks, startle, fly up. The grass turns emerald green in the strange light of the approaching storm. The finches are butter yellow against an iron blue sky. The beauty is mine to keep. The wind doesn't care, doesn't care, doesn't care. Chapter 1. I went to 3 different colleges before I managed to snag an undergraduate degree. And considering how callow I was in those days, it's a wonder I learned anything at all. But looking back, I believe I learned 3 things. 2 are irrelevant to our purposes here, but 1 has some bearing. A professor at the first of those colleges penetrated my attention sufficiently to impress upon me that there was no such thing as objective writing, that every inscription, every traveler's tale, every news account, every piece of technical writing tells more about the author and his times than it does about the ostensible subject. The best that can be hoped is that the writer will lay out his bias up front. I'm nearly half a century away from my college days, but everything I've ever read, including the scientific papers on biological subjects that I mine for my own writing, has convinced me that the professor was right. The writers of those papers, men and women I have interviewed and have come to know and admire, have selected their subjects because they have a passion for them. They have observed phenomena with an eye shaped by their experiences in particular places and times, and have found interest and significance according to their own gifts, limitations, sadnesses, and sociabilities. Their understandings have been shaped by their own peculiar and quirky worlds. One of the better achievements of Western thought is the scientific method, which, when it works well, makes allowances for all those passions, limitations, and quirks. A good field biologist goes out and looks at the real world, sees something no one else has noticed, writes it down as accurately as he can, and reports it to others through publication. On the basis of his observation, he or someone else may spin a theory that explains it. Other observers with other passions, later observers with other biases, check it out, supplement, amplify, disagree, revise. Science is a process, not a body of received wisdom. My own interests run to small animals that creep and jump and slither and flutter, the invertebrates, the little things that run the world, as E.O. Wilson has said. What I hope to do when I write, keeping my old professor in mind, is to tell about the world of invertebrates, which appears to me an interesting and engaging one. I try to lay out my biases up front. I'm grateful but astonished that over my writing life, one of the several lives I've had, sober, serious, responsible, grown-up editors have let me loose in that particular world to satisfy my own curiosity and amuse myself, in return for bringing back reports of what I see. There is a lot of news. Because we have backbones, vertebrae, we think they are important. So in one of those smug Aristotelian bifurcations, we have divided up the animals into vertebrates and invertebrates. Actually, it was Lamarck, the 18th century French naturalist, inventor of the notion that acquired characteristics could be inherited, who dreamed up the word invertebrates. But the idea goes back to Aristotle, the original digital thinker, a man who always divided things into 2 categories. His basic division of animals was into those that had blood and those that lacked it. By blood, he meant good, rich red blood, not the pale ichor that oozes from a bug when you squash it. And in the blooded category, he included mammals, birds, reptiles, and fishes. In short, vertebrates, animals with backbones. The bloodless were crustaceans, cephalopods, insects, and snails. In short, invertebrates. Or at least the ones he knew about. His scheme made further divisions of the 20 questions sort. Does the blooded animal have hair or is it hairless? Legged or legless? If it has legs, are there 4 or 2? This digital, yes or no approach, is familiar to anyone who has used a botanical key. Leaves alternate or opposite, stems fuzzy or smooth. Today, however, the basic principle of taxonomy is that living things should be defined by what they have, not what they lack. So taxonomic divisions come in varying numbers, not just in twos. The biological reference text I use divides all animals into 32 phylum units, of which animals with backbones are only one. But the Aristotelian way of thinking is powerful and still dominates our view of the world. College courses are taught and textbooks written on invertebrate zoology. The premier zoological research institutions of the world, such as the Smithsonian, have departments of vertebrate and of invertebrate zoology. Thoughtful taxonomists and zoologists grumble about this backbone fixation. One of them, Robert O'Hara, part philosopher, part zoologist, wondered how humans might be classified if an arthropod were making up the scheme. Arthropoda, meaning joint-footed, is the biggest phylum of animals, those that by numerical rights at least should do the classifying if they were so inclined. The phylum includes spiders, insects, crabs, and lobsters. An arthropod might, according to O'Hara, describe us and our near relatives this way. The anarthropods are a primitive group with few species and a limited diversity of form. Their reproductive rates prevent them from adapting to their environments closely, and the giantism exhibited by many anarthropods has kept their numbers very low and is no doubt the cause of their general sluggishness. The invertebrates could get along without us quite nicely, and did for hundreds of millions of years, but we could not get along without them. So dependent are we on the life processes they have initiated and keep going. We humans are a minority of giants stumbling around in the world of little things, often not noticing our neighbors, not even being able to see many of them because they are very small. Yet each and every species, constituted from the same basic handful of chemicals as we are, has a complicated and special way of getting on in the world, different from ours and different one from another. When we learn something about the way invertebrates live, they become familiar to us, and we develop some charity and friendliness toward them. I'm pleased to know that the woman who lives next door to Arne and me in Washington, D.C., has a home business that is thriving and that her children are doing well in school. I'm pleased also to know that the bumblebee I see in early springtime, working the azaleas in our front yard, is a solitary mother queen, hustling up enough provisions to raise daughters who will help her work during the months ahead. I find it satisfying and enjoyable to watch a periwinkle snuffling through the algae on a seaside rock near our new home in Maine, and know that it's having a good feed. Although we don't know everything about vertebrates, we know quite a lot. Occasionally a new bird or fish or mammal or reptile is discovered, but those discoveries are rare. So we know pretty well how many tens of thousands of vertebrate species there are, and we know a good deal about their biology and behavior. But more than 95% of the animal species are invertebrates, and we have discovered only a fraction of the suspected tens of millions of them. We know next to nothing about how they get on in their lives or what happens when we lurch through their communities. We don't even have a fix on the number of invertebrate species already known and described, which is surprising in these days of computer technology and catalogs. Nowhere in the world is there any tidy master list of all discovered species with their names neatly registered and affixed. Specialists in a particular group, the fireflies, for instance, usually have a fair notion of how many species there are in that group, but even those are educated estimates. And the numbers within bigger groupings, such as insects or sponges, are guesses. So we don't even know what we know. Anyone venturing among invertebrates is sure to have the pleasure of discovery. And nearly every observation becomes a piece of news from an uncharted world. That sort of pleasure is certainly one of the reasons zoologists go out into the field, and why I follow them there. In working with them, I have been struck as a writer with the similarity of our occupations. Both journalism and field biology require standing aside a little, playing observer, not participant, taking a look at the real world, interviewing its inhabitants one way or another, watching the manner in which they get along, and reporting what we've seen or heard. But more than that, both writers and biologists share a compulsion to describe to others how we see that world. We keep at it, publishing this bit now, another later, piling up reports of our own realities. A couple of books ago, I learned just how heady the pleasure of discovery could be and what a compulsion its pursuit becomes. In that book, Broadsides from the Other Orders, I was writing on several themes and using the biology and behavior of a particular bug to explore each one. I selected my bug examples in direct proportion to my own curiosity, which is to say ignorance about them. Silverfish, katydids, water striders, daddy longlegs, and so on. For 20 years I had been living on my farm in Missouri in close company with camel crickets. Pale, silent, humpbacked crickets with stripy brown jumping legs. When I looked them up in guidebooks, I found the same three or four tired facts about them, but nothing that satisfied. So I put camel crickets on my list for the book. My procedure, as chapter added to chapter, was to head down to the Library of Congress and spend several weeks reading everything I could find on the new chapter's bug. Usually by the end of that time, I had found the one person who was doing interesting work on it. I would telephone him or her and ask if I could come talk. Entomologists are generous people, and they invariably said yes. But with camel crickets, the situation was different. Very little was known about them, and nearly all of it had been discovered by one man who had died by the time I started my reading. A student of his, on the verge of retirement himself, had continued some of the taxonomic work, and he kindly identified the species I had on my farm. He also informed me that my species was a special kind that had piqued his mentor's interest. In fact, he gave me a paper written by that man near the end of his life, in which he described the species as a piece of unfinished business and a beckoning problem. Briefly, the paper explained that my camel crickets existed in a small area in and around my farm as an isolated group within a larger population that were thought to be the same species. When the males of this group matured sexually, they became puzzlingly different from the males outside, whom they otherwise resembled. They grew a bright orange bump on the back of what we would like to call their necks, but mustn't because bugs don't have necks. And the taxonomist told me no one knew anything about how camel crickets mated, for that act had never been seen. Perhaps the orange bump contained a food gift that males allowed the females to bite into during courtship. The contribution of a body part is a part of some insect wooings. Camel crickets of other species are common across the United States. They are nocturnal and live in basements, under piles of stacked lumber, in corners of garages, in country well houses, but none besides mine flaunted an orange bump. I learned to sex even immatures, captured a few males and females, and began keeping them in a terrarium. I figured out what they liked to eat, gave them water in bottle caps, learned that they were virtually blind and deaf, but received a startling array of information through their more-than-body-length antennae. I watched them molt and grow, and took notes on all this as much for myself as for the chapter I was to write for the book. And yes, I became the first person to see them mate and lay eggs. They mated in a contorted position, but the female never nibbled at the male's orange bump. For comparison, I began raising in separate terraria populations of camel crickets from 20 miles south of my farm, outside the range of my group. I discovered to my surprise that those males and females matured more slowly than did the ones from my farm, and therefore mated much later in the season. This meant that in the wild, the two populations would never interbreed. Could they? I isolated immature males and females from both populations and kept them cloistered in single-gender terraria until the ones lacking the orange bump were ready to breed, and then mixed them, pair by pair, in still other terraria. By this time, my chapter on camel crickets had long since been written and the book published, but I was still fired with the delight of investigation. In those days, I was regularly commuting the 1,010 miles between my Missouri farm and the house in Washington in a van loaded with manuscripts, source books, two dogs, a cat, the unabridged dictionary, and the 11th edition of the Encyclopedia Britannica. To that pile, I added a good many terraria of camel crickets. In the end, I found that the two populations could be induced in this artificial way to interbreed, and that their offspring were fertile, so that by the common definition they did indeed belong to the same species. That definition holds that a species is made up of individuals that interbreed and produce fertile offspring. But the offspring of these forced matches were frequently deformed. Some could not molt successfully, and often died before their time. Does the orange bump of the speedily maturing group contain a hormone that hastens development? Are the two groups genetically distinct? Is the orange bump group a species in formation? Or, alternatively, a primitive group? My farm bordered a geologically unusual area that contains plants relict from the Ice Age. Might my camel crickets be relict, too, from a time when the season was shorter? I haven't the equipment, skills, or training to answer those questions, but they spurred me, when I finally admitted that I had to give up the farm, to place it with an organization that will keep it, and the camel crickets, forever wild and safe. There were, to be sure, additional reasons for that decision, but the presence of the unusual camel crickets contributed to it. It's my hope that someday a young entomologist will stumble across something I've written and go looking for camel crickets with bright orange bumps one springtime. He may answer those questions, but he will ask others. That's the way the process goes. There will always be people who believe that watching camel crickets is an unsuitable way for a grown-up to spend her time and energies. One reason for the lack of information about camel crickets was that although they are an extremely common insect, big and easy to observe, they have little relevance to humans. They neither help nor harm us. Most research is driven by the availability of funding, and funding agencies need to see a payback. Will research on this particular oddly named animal we have never heard of improve human life in some demonstrable way? If we fund the research, will we find a better way to kill the animal if we believe it to be harmful, or to encourage it if we find it beneficial? Camel crickets, in that sense, are neither good nor bad bugs. In this, they resemble most of the life on the planet. In the very short run, the one in which research funding takes place, it's hard to show that much of what lives and grows in the world relates to us. We eat salmon, but not sea mice. The elusive Aphrodite, a genus of worms that live in the ocean deeps, where, some scientists say, there may be as many as 10 million other species, as unconcerned with our existence as we are ignorant of theirs. Certain black flies cause a terrible tropical disease in humans, river blindness. But camel crickets do not make us sick, nor do most of the more than 1 million other species of insects. Sensible, practical concerns should and do make salmon and black flies of more importance and interest in the funding of research and the formation of public environmental policy than camel crickets or Aphrodite or those other nameless millions. That's the way of the world, or at least of our time in the world. I must confess, however, that I've never been convinced that to be interesting and important, an animal needs to have a relationship to or use for human beings. As a matter of fact, otherness, remoteness, and independence engage my curiosity and intellect more than do similarity and utility. And I think there are a number of good long-term reasons why we should persist in our interest in camel crickets and sea mice and all those millions of invertebrates awaiting discovery. Some of those reasons will turn up in the pages that follow. But here, initially, I want to return to this compulsion that we have, writers and naturalists, to become tellers of tales about the world we have traveled in. My brother, Bill Gilbert, a writer whose preoccupations run to animals with backbones, most especially crows, has often written of our fascination with other bloods as the basis of our yearning to understand the ways of others, as an escape from mere human perspective. But it's my son, Brian Hubbell, also a writer, a poet, who has said it best of all. Poets often do. He wrote in a 1996 issue of the Beloit Poetry Journal, "The Message." Dry September weekday morning. Time indolence equates to sin. I was outside, eyes closed over coffee, thinking some things, I think, when a grasshopper flew in a certain fury, arcing off the desiccating asters, and affixed itself sharply to my upper lip, returning startled with a compound stare, a ceaseless green-on-green. Buttoned in its urgent grip, words came as plain as under a falcon pigeon's ring or in a half-corked bottle. Surely the heart of sadness is this knowing. Each embarks a gulf alone, each with his fractured bit of seeing and a need, but not the tools to tell. Chapter 2. I found the bicycle at a yard sale. Its front wheel was a little out of round, and the brakes didn't work, but it still had a couple of gears to choose from, and it was a pretty thing, so I bought it. Back home I tinkered with it, and one morning I swung up onto the seat and pedaled to the oceanfront park a mile down the road from our new home in Maine. I wasn't allowed a bicycle when I was growing up because my mother thought they were dangerous. So, of course, I was mad to have one, and the first purchase I made at college when I was safely away from the parental eye was a secret bicycle, which I rode for years thereafter, feeling rebellious, exhilarated, and slightly wicked all the while. The morning sky was deep blue. The sun shone through the trees lining the narrow road we share with the park. The air carried the fragrance of spruce and leaf mold I always associated with Maine during the years I came here as a mere visitor. Now I am a resident, and in the bicycle-created rush of air blowing my hair and jacket, I felt, in my seventh decade, rebellious, exhilarated, and gloriously happy. The brakes still didn't work very well, but that simply added to the zestiness of the ride. In the 19th and early 20th centuries, before air conditioning, the well-to-do from lower latitudes, known as rusticators, bought up the islands and promontories along the coast of Maine, including some of the peninsula where our place is. They built comfortable summer houses and called them cottages. The most beautiful spot on this peninsula was purchased by a Tammany politician who intended to build here but never got around to it. In the 1920s, he donated the land to the town at the head of the peninsula. The park created from his land is a mere 10 acres, but it is grand, if not in extent, in prospect, geology, and, as it turns out, intertidal invertebrate populations. I was bicycling down there, invertebrate survey, census, and field guides in hand, because I wanted to become acquainted with those populations. I fastened my bicycle to a post around which a wild rose was blooming extravagantly. Beyond the roses, beyond the sheltering growth of fir, spruce, and birch, the rocks began. Massive pink granite bluff and boulders with an exposure to the southeast. Waves crashed against the rocks and sent up wide plumes of spray, forced their way through fissures where they became jets of water sparkling in the morning sunshine. To the south and east lay islands, and beyond them, the open sea. I looked outward until the earth's curve took away my vision. The land here in coastal Maine is, geologically speaking, new and raw. Its creation and extraordinary forces that accomplished it can be read upon its exposed rocks. The granite is sundered, its fissures filled with black basalt, making stripy roadways down to the sea. At ocean edge, a rock outcropping shelters all behind it and helps create pools when the tide goes out. Beside the outcropping, the boulders give way to heaps of smaller rocks and cobbles, testimony to transforming forces. Geologists can read these rocks and can read also the stories written by fossils of invertebrates that swam the ancient seas, lapping far to the west of the Atlantic's edge today. Their readings change with new discoveries and revised geological theory, but at present, the story is something like the following. Formations of rocks along the Maine coast are the same as many in Ireland and England, telling of a time when the continents were configured differently. 700 million years ago, and for millions of years thereafter, an island that contained these formations, named Avalonia, lay to the east of the major portion of the North American landmass, separated from it by an ocean named Iapetus, for one of the Titans, those beings who came before the gods. Avalonia included land that today can be found in Britain, Newfoundland, New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, Massachusetts, and Maine. I have trouble understanding 700 million years ago, a trouble going back to my earliest years, when I spent more effort than was probably healthy, struggling with adult constructs of time's extent. In those days, my father was a superintendent of parks and cemeteries in Kalamazoo, Michigan. Part of his pay package was the use, for our home, of a fine old rambling house in one of the cemeteries. Attached to the house, across a hallway, was the cemetery office, and the people who worked there were surprisingly tolerant of my coming to play in a corner of it, eavesdropping on cemetery business. One day I heard the secretary tell a customer that for the basic price of a burial plot, the family would be responsible for mowing and maintaining the grave, but for somewhat more money, the cemetery offered perpetual care. What did perpetual care mean? I asked the secretary as soon as the customer left. It means we'll mow it, take care of it forever, she explained. What is forever? I asked. It means the grass gets mowed after those people die, after their children die, after I die, after you die. Me? Die? That was new, too. And I wondered what happened next. Well, everything keeps on, you know. You'll have children, and they'll have children, and I think maybe it's time you ran back across the hall and went home. For many years afterward, as I learned about things that lasted a long time, the British Empire, the age of dinosaurs, the formation of the solar system, I would check out the years of duration against this disturbing idea of perpetuity, of forever, and found that none of them measured up. I learned that empires fall, that animals become extinct, that the solar system had a birth and would have a death. I developed a strong suspicion that grass, maybe even trees, would grow over those cemetery plots someday as if they never had existed. Forever, it appeared, was a word made up by adults so they would not have to think about endings. Eventually, as was right and proper, I grew up and understood that perpetuity simply means until a government falls or loses interest. A friend who is an attorney told me not long ago that a recent national survey of legal documents shows that forever lasts about 30 years on average. But if forever can mean until governments fall or lose interest, what does 700 million years mean when the whole history of governments, the very idea of governments, is subsumed into inconsequence by that span of time? I've had more than 20 dogs as companions during my lifetime. None of those dogs has lived beyond 16 years. But in that time has managed to pack in a full schedule of bumptious puppyhood, some good middle years of chasing rabbits and being a credit unto himself or herself, and sedate snoozes on a dog bed toward the end. My mother and father were both born in 1900. My father died young, but my mother lived well into her 90s, near the century's end. I can comprehend 100 years without any trouble in thinking of their lifetimes, during which the telephone, the automobile, air travel, and the fax machine brought the world close. A time during which this country took part in several wars over matters thought important enough to kill for. A time during which we have rushed from pre-modern to post-modern. 1,000 years? I can't comprehend that span in my bones, but intellectually I can take it in. It is approximately the time from the Norman conquest of Britain to the present. It contains nearly all the kings and wars, philosophy, art, literature, music, scientific discoveries, and explorations that we call Western civilization. 1,000,000 years? 1,000 of those thousands? That is hard. It is roughly half the time something designatably human has been around. But for the geologist or invertebrate zoologist, let alone an astronomer, it is simply a number tucked up into margin of error. 700 million years ago becomes something on the order of long, long ago or once upon a time. And that is not a bad way to tell of the beginnings of this beautiful little park, of the beginnings of Maine, although not of the beginnings of invertebrate life. For even then, even once upon a time, 700 million years ago, invertebrates had been around for a while. And life itself, cheerfully replicating and altering its forms, can be marked only in years numbering billions. So then, once upon a time, in an era called Precambrian, the ancient seas contained a rich worldwide population of soft-bodied invertebrate animals. Because their bodies were soft, they did not fossilize well. Also, many of the sediments into which they sank as they died are not accessible to us today because they...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.